open to sexual possibilities of recombination. We've actually had other brassicas crossing, giving, and then those seeds were planted out, and now we have tree-colored mixes that have more Valencianado type of dark green leaf that's longer and bluish, you know, darker, that are new strains of the tree-colored that have only arisen in the last couple years because of this very rare flowering, gives an opportunity for a little something new. So these seeds, make sure that you, when these start to get dry, you don't have many other brassicas here, so you probably won't get something new, but it's an opportunity right now to get another brassica that's flowering in Be the Bee. This is definitely a star place here in the Bay Area for permaculture learning and demonstration. This place is only 4 years old now, so it's just a baby, but you can see what could happen in 4 years.
This is going to be a provocative tour, because you're going to see a lot of stuff that we're not doing at the farm. And no, that's a very healthy and good thing. I mean, even though it's quite young and very productive, plants are healthy, they're strong. So when you first come in, see what you can get from a place, what you can before it's interpreted for you, and before anyone, even, you know, before anyone sets any kind of context. Train yourself to get a good reading. Immediately you can feel that when you come into here. Just driving in the road, you can feel it.
Culture community here in Northern California. But before you walk away, brother, I want to introduce you to, I'm keeping an eye on you, buddy. So let me just, come on up here. We'll talk about Eric for a minute. Eric Olson's really the heart of this place. He kind of visioned this and worked with all of us to make it happen, but he really took it on financially, emotionally. He's got a young family. He's got a successful permaculture design and build business called Permaculture Artisans. And Michael
here
is one of his brothers. What, you guys went to high school together and everything, right?
Yes,
I mean, kid days,
16, 17 years old and still going.
And
still
so you you help run the cruise?
Yep. I'm project manager for Permaculture Artisans here. Obviously, Eric has made, beyond that, has made the Permaculture Skill Center, which is a class. Today is the first day of that class, so we have quite a buzzing day here as you guys come through and that other class comes through.
So operations for Permaculture Artisans operate out of here.
Uh-huh.
Can you want to mention, talk a little bit about that aspect, which was really the foundation of Eric learning? We're teaching together out at Occidental Arts and Ecology Centers.
Which 15. We took that course together.
Awesome.
And then
awesome.
From there, Penny picked us up on her landscaping crew that she had, Eric and myself, and actually Dave, another person who works with us, so it goes way deep.
And then
we moved on from there. I mean,
so Penny Livingston, if you don't know, is one of the original permaculture students and teachers and designers here in the Bay Area. She grew up in West Marin and right there in Marin City. And she's been at it for a long time, and even when I lived in Hawaii, I would come and visit her because she's like Penny Livingston. I'd come sit at
beautiful
her feet,
woman.
and I'd make a suggestion. Oh yeah, we do this in Hawaii. Come back like 9 months later, and she'd have it all like primoed out. Like, oh, we make tanks like this, and she'd already have one up with fish in it and everything. So these guys come out of these permaculture courses and go into working with the best, doing landscape design and implementation, which is.
And as we know in permaculture, the problem is the solution. So we have here an excess of water. What do we do with it? So a lot, if you guys haven't already talked about this, but swales are a huge feature in permaculture gardens.
And how does that work? What is a swale?
A swale can work in a couple different ways, but you could see basically it helps to move water on contour instead of off the land. It helps water to seep into the ground to create water lenses over time, which trees and perennials can tap into.
So we're down, instead of, how does Brock say, instead of running water, we want walking water. So we slow it,
spread it
out,
it,
and sink it in.
It.
Slow, spread, sink.
So this is a swale, right?
So that is a swale right there. And then now some swales can be completely on contour where when it fills, it just stays there. And then just sinks in. And
like some, a percolation basin sometimes are called also.
So if you have a hill like this, you're putting it this way so it stays on contour. So when the water runs down, it fills in this and it stays in that swale and then sinks in. And then there's more or less kind of creek-like swales, which are slightly off contour.
Once that swale is full, once the soil is saturated,
it fills up enough that it then overspills out and then continues into another part or section of your hill, continuing with your swale and your movement. And again, depending on how much water is there, you either want to create it so the swales get full and always stay full, or if the water has more movement to it. Here, the water is actually so, it's such a slight grade change. And it makes a difference here because we have such a high water.
Pretty
flat. Yeah, exactly. So, you know, any small, in the winter, it's amazing to see how quick all of these sections get filled. But it actually slightly moves and it all heads back, and there's a whole system that's integrated. Mm-hmm.
That we're gonna walk back there with you guys.
And then goes back to the pond that's in the back and then beautiful. Heads out and continues to the laguna because we're part of that whole laguna system. Yep.
So, we're infiltrating as much as we can, storing it, but at the same time, you have to know about your drainage too, because we get a lot of rains and sometimes you're at capacity. For any of your tanks, rain catchment, whatever it is, when you're full to capacity, then what? So you need to save it, but you also need to know what to do with the surplus. So that's the balance. Some people are so focused, blessed, into saving the water.
Covering your soil with a nice layer of mulch, allowing water to percolate in without just being sucked dry, as well as, John, I'm sure we'll be talking about the different trees around here.
It's raining.
But yeah, providing nitrogen-fixing trees.
What?
That actually help fix the soil.
Nitrogen-fixing this?
With good nutrients. So here we have an autumn olive. This is strictly here, more or less, to provide nitrogen for the ground.
But it's also an edible. So it's a nitrogen fixing, it makes little berries. Eleagnus is the genus. And can be weedy back east where it rains in the summertime, but here, because what's blessing about California is because the summer dryness, we can really control things a lot by where we put water in the summertime. So this one's very drought tolerant and can survive in a drier summer, so it's a great low water plant also. But it's productive, and even if we decide to cut it back a lot and release nitrogen from the root zone, it'll still come back and make fruits, you know. That's the problem with common names.
Right, an autumn olive, and it's not. Right.
The leaves look olive-like. That's the only connection at all. It's Eleagnus. It has a little berry related to gumi, which is the more summertime version of this. Mm-hmm. The autumn olive is in August or September. And then there's one in June and July that's called gumi. That's another Eleagnus. You can also eat the berry, yeah.
So just to call to your attention.
There's bigger ones behind you there, see? Those are all them. Autumn olives.
So our guides and also building around the teaching of the landscape, the genius of the place.
A lot of permaculture is based on observation. Stopping there. just think about that. Observation. To sit and to observe and then to take note. And that's a lot of what permaculture is. And you'll be told through that observation how to build and how to move forward.
Yeah, I mean, you get credit for spacing out. You're just sitting there like waiting for something to happen. And it may not be quick or fast, but it's happening. Can you catch it? Can you observe it? Is it happening so fast you might miss it? Or is it happening so slow you might miss it? You have to expand your time frame. Think about processes. So in this particular place, having grown out of a successful landscaping business, and applying permaculture principles of kind of synergistic things working together, diversity, all these sustainability concepts that we work with in permaculture, how can we not only apply that to a business successfully? He did that. How many crews you got going? How many projects you got going? Right now, he's got a full-time, draftsperson in there with the CAD. You know what I'm saying? Computer-assisted drawing stuff. He's got the whole project manager thing going on. I mean,
the materials handler.
Yeah.
Just the guy bringing materials.
Just one person ordering stuff and making sure it gets delivered on time. So they've got the logistics down of how to get these landscapes out in the community. The next step was, how can we empower more people to not only do the same for themselves at home, which I think is the priority for everybody, mm-hmm. but not everybody's ready for that. So how can we provide that service for others in the larger community beyond just Eric's, but expanding that out? Now, how's that for a business strategy? I'm going to get in the business of not only creating landscapes, but empowering other people to do the same thing.
Right.
But to find their own niche, to find their own specialty, and bringing in all these experts. So right now they have the Sustainable Landscape Immersion course that's starting today. We just happened to show up on the same day. The other program that's going to start in about six months, will be the Sustainable Landscaping one.
The farm school.
Thank you. There. So sustainable landscaping is more, putting in landscapes, and the other one is the farm school. Farm school is straight up farming. Now, we're going to show you vegetable beds over here where it's more like you're familiar at the farm with rows and everything, but all these aspects can be integrated to any farming system. Some people will focus on tree crops. Some will be focusing on the medicinal herbs. Some people will be focusing on annuals. Some will be integrating all of those together. And the angle is going to be right in here, whereas in the summer solstice, it's going to rise a little bit farther back and go a little bit higher in the sky. Winter, it'll be down here lower, right? So that's one of the sectors, the sun sector. We have the wind sector. We get some coastal winds here sometime. On a hot day, we might get it from back this side. So looking at, we have highway noise, right? We have a big swap meet across the street. So that's another sector of accessibility and also kind of privacy in the back. So there's a gradient here. So looking at not only the energies coming in, but how we access out into the land is our zonation, we call it in permaculture, how accessible things are. Because we're close to the building here, this is a fairly frequented area. We come here quite often. As it going between this building and that building, there's a lot of interaction, right? Whereas the farther you go back, hello, it's like, well, we get out there once a week. Or maybe the animal person's going there twice a day, but otherwise not very many other people are. So their zonations is about accessibility to harvest or maintain something. So that's how we arrange things. We try to arrange the things that need most attention to take care of or to harvest close in or along a trail or an access point. And the things that don't need us so much are gonna be farther and farther away, right? It's just how you arrange your wallet or your car or whatever, your bookshelf. Same thing, as that's how we're gonna make it practical here. So in looking at that, I think we should maybe start with zone one, spin around there, and look at some of the energy and water projects that we have involved here in permaculture. We're looking at sustainable energy production. We have a solar array that's integrated with the site here. There's some roof catchments on some of the shelters here that we can look at. And we'll just take a quick tour around this garden and look at some of the intensive techniques they're using right in this area, and take a spin out to some of the garden plots, and head back through the garden and to the animal area in the back there. We won't have bees visiting these flowers, possibly infecting them. So I'm pulling off the last blooms, preventing another pair that's maybe late flowering from getting any. But now that we've removed, now that we've removed all those flowers, I'm less worried about this tree getting fire blight, and we have plenty of, see how many pears we still have on here? You can see all the little pears. So this is just one idea. Oh, look at the yarrow.
Love the rosemary.
The
oregano.
Everybody should know this one.
Mine.
Working on the farm. Yeah. What do you guys see in there? Anything?
They might be hiding this time of day, but when you have water, you have life. And my brother, Brock Dolman, they come in and out of there, which are really important for pest control. I'm talking about all the frogs and salamanders, all these kinds of critters that are attracted to this. A toad can eat hundreds of insects a night. So having this habitat here, things can access it. Notice how it's made. There's a deep part, but there's also shallow parts where animals can climb in and out. That's really important. Don't make your water features like a bowl, because things will get caught in there and drown. Make sure there's ramps for them to get in and out so they can come to drink but not fall in. And I also like to have little marshy, gravelly areas where butterflies and other small insects with small mouth parts can just lap on the moist rocks. That's a really important habitat feature of a little pond like this. The running water is important, not only for the sound, but the aeration of the water keeps it healthy. Notice how shaded it is. So when you have a shaded pond, it can actually consume oxygen in the water when it respirates at night. So you have during the day photosynthesis, but at night it's respirating all those sugars it created, and it can actually suck oxygen out of the water. So green ponds that are in the full sun aren't necessarily the best. So we like to shade them with plants, either above ground plants like trees and shrubs, or floating plants on the surface of the water to help reduce the sun coming in. That keeps it nice and clear so the animals can take advantage of it. And then you can skim all that fertility off the top very easily, like the azolla, like the water hyacinth or duckweed or the pistia, the water lettuce, any of those things. Get a bamboo pole, scrape it off, and harvest your... I do like green water though. Ducky water where they're cleaning their bills and pooping it up. Maybe we'll see some back there. Using that to actually use the water to carry the fertility somewhere else is a great strategy too. So sometimes you want it in the sun to get it all green and funky. Sometimes you want to keep it nice and clear like this. And the way you do that is some shade. So I love this area. It's close in. We're probably talking, I'm talking too loud. There's these offices here. So they're running the whole business out of this building. Some grapes. These are all pressed flat against there. And in the foreground were these shrubs. What are we looking at? Everybody? Blueberry.
Blueberry. Blueberry. Blueberry. Blueberry. Blueberry. Blueberry. Blueberry. Blueberries. Yara, what's this? What are these?
Strawberry.
What kind of strawberry is that?
That's the alpine strawberry. Have you tasted the...
Welcome.
Hey, thank you. We're looking for some propaganda. You got some brochures for us? Cool. Introduce yourself, please. Tell us what you do. Who are you? Why are you here?
Well, I don't know why I am here. Eric Sebastian. I do the water systems design for Eric at Permaculture Artisans.
That's what you do.
Main tanks. We do RCD projects.
What's RCD?
The resource conservation districts in the area. And I mean, you guys are down Marin, right?
Yes.
There's some fantastic state money and federal money being funneled through RCDs, NRCS for conservation and restoration projects. Down by you, huge carbon farming push, as you probably are aware of. Up by us is a lot of emphasis on the salmon-bearing creeks, improving summer water flows and water quality. And particularly with that Bond 1, the state money coming through for watershed management, there's a lot of support to the community about actually restoring groundwater, protecting surface water, and that whole water carbon.
So you don't have to come out of pocket, maybe at first, but there are reimbursements to do the right thing.
Yeah.
To get your swales in, to get your ponds, your roof catchment, your groundwater, whatever it is, there is support in the community, not only with great folks like these and Daily Acts and stuff, but I'm talking about the county and state levels and federal levels where the government sees, hey, this is worth doing. We're saving money in the long run by doing the right thing.
Yeah, awesome. You really want to know your local RCDs. Fantastic people.
Resource Conservation District and NRCS Natural, the Feds Natural Resources Conservation Service used to be called the Soil Conservation Service. They expanded it to natural resource. It means water too, right? It's all connected. So
Marine Carbon Project and the seat of some organizations that are really seeing how can we divert state funds. They usually go to these really large scale systems. How do we get them down to the farmers?
Tibicinas, you know, the princess bush, untouched by frost. They had all kinds of stuff. I said, try cherimoyas up here. Look at this. This citrus tree got froze out and the rats got to it. See the vole damage here? This is vole damage. This is a little field mice.
So John, just pausing here for a second, John.
Yeah, look at this. No, look at this shady edge here with the berries.
The paving. So they, both John and Michael mentioned how important the walkways are. This reason, you know, one of the projects that we did not get to do last year, last season, exactly a year ago after the farmstead was after the farm stand was created on the at Indian Valley, was to add cream in the kind of rough gravel that it has when it dries out and has a lot of dust. And it's not so nice to stand on. So, or looking at how beautifully they've done this
flagstone.
Flagstone with the mints in between.
Yeah, it allows for the creep gooseberries. Native gooseberry. Now they're small and thorny, but they are kind of edible. What do we have out here?
Thimbleberries.
Yes, this needs the water, so don't think it's drought tolerant.
What's it called?
Thimbleberries. They're like the most delicate little raspberry you've ever imagined. They're like a little thimble. They fit like a little cap, and they're very tender, and they like water though.
They
don't like dry. These in the proper place with more water would be twice as tall. And all flowering now. These are stressed. They don't get enough water here. And then we have some natives and non-natives. The Budleia is not, but this is the, who knows this one? What do you call that one? What is it?
Isn't it twinberry?
These tall ones.
Yes.
Toyon berries?
No. Sorry, I don't know what they are.
What's that red thing right next
what are
to
they?
Your face?
No, they're not dogwoods. This one, smoke bush. An ornamental, a nice ornamental. So and then of course the California native sword fern, little random vetches and stuff, and sub clovers or burr clovers we love. And notice the spillway going into the reeds here. And then yet another water feature. Oh my God, there's a nice water feature. Watch out for the skunk, I don't know where he is. Notice the little espalier citrus. More fragrant plants. Look at the swamp in here. This is an edible celery, an aquatic celery plant. I'm sure you could grab a little piece of that if you wanted. Different kinds of thyme here. Look at this little guy, found a little niche there. That's pretty awesome. A seed found a little clump of moss to grow in. So, no kids in the pond. They had to put that because I jumped into one of Eric's ponds at one of his parties, you know. No kids. It says down here, no kids in the pond. But see, it's just coming back to life here. It's very frost sensitive. So you can see it's died back. The tops have died back, but it's starting to emerge now. See the beautiful little elephant-like ears? It's an aroi. You know, caladiums or elephant ear. But the whole plant is edible if you cook it. But that's also found here. See it here? That's it too, coming back to life. See the little green starting to come out? Bless, it likes it warm. It doesn't like frost, so it's just waking up now. So, south, what other big trees do you see over here? If these ones over here don't look as big, but see these ones over here with the shiny leaves? They're pretty large for a fruit tree. Can you identify them from this distance? The shiny leaves. Come on, you guys, we've been invited in. Cosmo, boom, they get up tall, bugs love them, straight cut flowers, long stems.
Lots of color in the front here.
Yeah. So you can see what care is being taken here to get through all this stuff, which, you know, you could drop the back end of a tractor through here and have it done in a minute. They're really caring in a really hand-cared way here. And I'll tell you, having sandy soil really helps. And they're doing it at a great time of the year. The rains have backed off, it's warming up, it's not too wet, and it's not dried out yet, and where you destroy the whole crumb structure completely. Using this big fork, there's a lot of intact root kind of masses that are gonna be decomposing as the plants get cleared off. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Enjoy. And then there's probably some sensors down here. What else? What it might be? Humidity and
temperature.
Evapotranspiration, it's usually a formula, but sometimes they can measure that. But the other one that's important is relative humidity, and then air pressure or atmospheric pressure. So right now it's high pressure because it's clear.
Right.
When the storm's going to blow through this weekend, whether we get any precipitation or not, you can watch the barometer drop. That's the atmospheric pressure. So this is continuous readings. Otherwise, we would have three dials in the shade next to a building, and we'd have to be making a note of it. And that's the old way. It's been done since the 1800s when they had ways to quantify and measure these things. Otherwise, it was all relative. It was hot that day. It was cold. What plants died was the measurement. Now we have an absolute measurement of Fahrenheit or centigrade, right? So that's the new method. And so what this is good for is documenting. Is it predictive? Only thing. So,
please step up so you can see. So, it's important feature.
We don't like plastic that much. Sometimes we'll use cardboard and mulch and stuff, but this is a technique to use black plastic or 100% shade cloth to solarize an area, to, you know.
Transitional efforts.
Yeah, exactly. So this isn't a permanent thing. We're gonna peel this off and plant into it after a couple more months when we think all the plants have kind of burned themselves out trying to resprout. They'll be weakened, have used up the reserves in their root system that's hiding under there. And so it could be bindweed, it could be some running grasses, they're all problems. And
we also talked last week and we looked at
this. This is a really tall one.
Yeah.
Come on, let's go through the pathway, it's better. Just a better entry. Oh, farm stand. We're at the farm stand. The public's invited to come here. Is there anything for sale in here right now? The culvert that we roll around in. So here it is. Read what it says here. Somebody.
Rain catchment system. Rainwater harvesting equals less irrigation, reduced water bills, less strain on public storm water systems, emergency preparedness.
So this time of the year, thank you. This time of the year, we're full. We should be full, right? It's been raining. We haven't been needing to irrigate that much because the rains have been pretty good. It's starting to get dry enough now. So yeah, you can see it as we and see these are trees from last year that were grafted. Now these haven't been trained, I think, as well as ours. Our farm. I'm being critical here. And let me also say, when we're visiting a farm, we're trying to learn. We're not here to say it's wrong or anything, right? We're just trying to learn because every way is plausible. I would say that these have nice branching, but I might have directed them to maybe one branch.
Sweet.
Oh my, I want to live in here.
I could train.
Getting all the parts of it. And I have three different species of arugula and all that stuff just naturally self-seeds. And I have rainbow chard, just keeps on coming up every year. I let a few flower and seed out. So that's kind of how I do a lot of my vegetables. It can be kind of naturalized, and even some of the annuals. But mixing production and harvesting and selling it with these catches, like they're called catches. You see that little bowl? Mm-hmm. Did you see that? That was a bowl.
It wasn't a lizard.
No, it looked like a lizard, but it was a little ball of fur about this big. It went through here, and because it's so light, it bounced off the wall and couldn't, they ate the artichoke.
Just for that?
This is sharp.
Notice that in close,
Pennywort.
We have a human-centered kind of attraction here with the fire pit. We have a... and then these are... Anybody know what this is? Yes, this is a dwarf cattail. This isn't our big native one. This is a dwarf one, so it won't take over as fast. Cattails are probably one of the number one biomass producers that we can grow. Not just for animal feed, but there's actually edible tubers, or rhizomes properly, under there The fibers are used for weaving, and then the cobs you can eat the pollen of, et cetera, and use it for fire starter, right? It's just one of those amazing permaculture plants.
And remember, we have a whole class on the 23rd with Diana Almendarez teaching us about using tules.
Oh, yes. And these drainages, when they fill up with water, the excess goes down these ditches along the sides, and it all ends up in here. Now, remember how sandy the soil is?
Yes.
This has a liner. This has a liner. Or they brought in clay. I can't remember which.
They brought
There's
in clay.
Some, what's that?
I was here 2 years ago, and there was a bunch of clay
Thank
in the liner.
Thank you. So they brought in clay, because I know you can't hold it now. Now, as you get closer to the laguna, it gets more and more clay. But up here, where the road is the ridge. Roads are on ridges, right? Because they're the most well-drained.
Exactly.
So this 116 Gravenstein Highway is going down the spine of a ridge. Over there you see the poultry wagon, the poultry palace there, where all the eggs are being produced. They can be let out on a daily basis.
Wait, where is it?
Right over there with the green roof.
Oh. Polyfaces, it's called. Polyface farm uses a variety, a succession of animals in the landscape to take advantage of different food sources and to leave the land in a better position than they found it, in the sense of rotating these animals through so they each eat a different thing. And he has, they like dandelions. I think you got a dandelion bait here.
Come on.
So let me just warn you about these guys. They can't, they're camelids, they do spit, they can bite. Mm-hmm. So, hi.
He's like, yeah, you heard that. I spit.
What do they do with all
long shoots come out and they cut them back to a fist? Yeah. Oh, it's so unnatural. Come on. Have you been out and walked, looked at some oak trees that the deer have been browsing on? Very unnatural, isn't it? The manzanitas that are like this big, and the oak trees that get wider and wider until the deer can reach the middle, and then the tree becomes its full self, right? And down at the bottom is that little browse zone that's just like a little shrub, and then this big oak emerges out of the middle where it can't reach. So
anybody who visits us.
Will your neighbors tolerate that? Do you have a reason to have an alarm system? It could be. But who has heard a guinea fowl?